welcome to the left wing, where Leinster put on a show in the first half at Croke Park on Saturday night. And that proved enough to decide their derby with Munster. It was a tighter game in Belfast. Ulster edged Connacht, and the Ireland women's team rounded off their year with an excellent second place in the WXV1 tournament. Sinéad Kissane here. I'm sitting in for Will Slattery. Luke Fitzgerald and Rory O'Connor are here in studio. How are you, lads?
Good, thanks.
Good.
How are you, Will? Luke, Leinster versus Munster isn't a real rivalry anymore and never will be again. That's according to Eamon Sweeney in the Irish Independent on Monday. Would you be on board with that?
I don't think so. Like, I think the gap is certainly, it's definitely going to be hard to bridge. But I'm still a big believer that these things kind of go in cycles. I think maybe Leinster might have sorted that out a little bit. Like, I'm obviously probably hearkening back to a period before I arrived into Leinster and at the start of my Leinster career where Munster were a far superior team to us. And then you had periods in the 80s where, you know, Ulster were very strong, Leinster were strong, and then Munster, you know, so I may be hearkening back to that. I do think Leinster have a fairly well-oiled machine in place, and I think they'll probably be more consistent than that going forward. And I think the schools game seems to produce a fairly regular amount of talent for them that they can draw on. But my sense is that I think the other provinces, I think, will improve over time too. And I think the best solution, and I think they will eventually come to this conclusion, is that they will have to share out some of the resources that Leinster have that are just sitting by the wayside, not getting enough game time with the other provinces. Now, that happens generally, but I think it happens a little bit too late, if you're asking me. I think if you look at the resources and you look where the population of the country is, it's a massive advantage for Leinster. And I think they need to share out those resources earlier to the other provinces.
What do you mean?
Well, I think what happens is people end up sitting on the Leinster bench for maybe three, four years, and then they decide, well, actually, I think I need to go and start my career somewhere else. It's very hard at that point to give up your dream. But I think someone, if someone takes that decision out of your hands, I think it could be the best for your career too, you know. For whatever reason, people seem to be staying in Leinster, I think, a little bit too long. And I think we're missing out on some possibly really, you know, like top quality professional players. And I think, look, people given opportunities and, you know, more good players around them in other provinces, I think you might see a couple of international players come out of that group too that we don't see. So that's, to my mind, that's the future. I don't think the RFU have been able to implement that yet. It'd be pretty tricky from a HR standpoint too to say you got to go and live somewhere else. But you do it in lots of other professions. And I think it'd be the most efficient use of the resources we have because we don't have a massive playing pool to pick from. So that's my... to answer your question in a very long-winded way, I think they'll get this right, and I think it won't be as uneven going forward.
I don't think you can, like, even taking all that, go back to Saturday, I don't think you can write a rivalry that just attracted 82,000 people to a stadium off as a dead duck just because one team got on top in the early stages and the game wasn't as competitive as it might have been. I think Munster still have a good chance of beating Leinster in Thomond Park later this season. I think if the two teams meet in a knockout game later on in the year, yes, Leinster will be favourites, but I wouldn't write off Munster. You know, the Orgy Snyman thing added to the rivalry this time. If it wasn't a rivalry, Munster fans wouldn't care as much that their best player or one of their best players had changed sides to them and wouldn't be booing them in the stadium. You can't judge it on one fixture. Leinster definitely have the upper hand right now, but that almost makes Munster want to beat them more. I do think Munster are getting better year on year in terms of their organisation. I think they're catching up on Leinster in certain regards. And one fixture where Leinster performed really well and blew Munster out of the water, things didn't go Munster's way. They already had a pretty difficult injury list coming into it. To be definitive on a rivalry based on that, I think is too much.
The last critical match these two teams played, Munster won.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, these are all these league games. We can see, like, Leinster have had a trophy-less cabinet for longer than Munster.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, look, as you mentioned there, Rory, was a devastating opening 15 minutes by Leinster. Three tries, it finished 26-12. Three tries in that opening 15 minutes. Then they obviously got their fourth try thanks to Orgy Snyman. So that continues their maximum haul from each game this season with their fourth bonus point win in a row. Luke, where do you want to start with this game?
Where to start? I think the same things that have kind of... I think we'll start with Munster. I think that's probably a good place to start. I think the same issues that Munster have had since the start of the season, even since the Connacht win, have probably reared their heads a little bit. I think they still have issues defensively that they need to resolve. It was a little bit too easy for Leinster in the tight exchanges to get go forward. And I think, you have enough challenges dealing with Leinster, in terms of the kind of width of the pitch and the dangers that they pose. They've got, you know, nice options, kicking options, all that kind of stuff. They use the width well. But if you're losing the battle in the kind of trenches, it becomes almost impossible to stop them. And I don't think there's any team in Europe, and I'd include probably Toulouse in that, that could stop them if you were losing ground tight to the rooks, which they were doing fairly consistently. Mm-hmm. And I think, they've had that issue all the way through. You think, back to some of the Connacht tries through the middle of their defence. Some good play from Connacht, in fairness, but that's the example that comes to my mind when I think of them. So Dennis Leamy is looking after that area. I expect him to get that right. He's very highly regarded. He's a guy I think very highly of, and I think the player group are very fond of him. So it just requires a little bit of thinking, a little bit of togetherness, and I don't know whether they need to organise their minds and get cohesive. If they do that, and they've done that really well towards the end of the last two seasons, if they do that a bit earlier, I think I think everything will calm down a little bit. But because you can see on the attacking side of the ball, they still pose some problems for Leinster. Mm-hmm. Now, they weren't very clinical at times. I didn't think the referee helped them on occasion. I'm sure we'll cover that too. But if they get the defensive piece sorted, I think they've got enough to cause any team in the competition trouble. And that's the glaring point that I think, when I think of Munster, where they are at the moment, to get sorted out.
Yeah, there have been some kind of harsh assessments of Munster after that game. Where would you have them after that?
I think we have to start off with the fact that we're four games in, and it's very early on. When it comes around to May, June, I still expect Munster to be firmly in the hunt for the URC. I think they're part of a second tier of European teams. Leinster are out with the favourites, Toulouse, Bordeaux and La Rochelle, who are the teams I think could probably win the tournament this year. Munster still are one or two tight five players away in particular. And they lost a lot of X factor last summer, and I don't think they replaced it. And even the times where they made busts or made gains on Saturday, I don't know if they had the players to... Now, it would have helped if the referee had let that pass go. That to me looked like a perfectly legitimate pass. Certainly go to the review. That's one time where they did cut them open and Calvin Nash scored. But there's just a little bit lacking in a clinical edge with the ball. And there's a softness about them without the ball that they need to cut out. I thought they fronted up really well against the Ospreys the previous week. And that looked like they'd solved a lot of their issues. But when Leinster went up a gear, they looked a bit shell-shocked in the first 10 minutes, 15 minutes. With Leinster's power, precision, pace, their lines of running, their options, they struggled to deal with that. Throw in the fact that their line-out collapsed, yeah, which you can't do against Leinster. There's a couple of things you can't do against Leinster. Don't let them into your 22 as much as possible. Obviously, they're going to get in there sometimes. And when you have opportunities, you got to take them. And when you get into Leinster's 22, you can't have the line-out malfunctions that we saw on Saturday.
It was obviously messy with Niall Scannell going off and Barron.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, no, it's
only missed again. A couple of kicks as well, I think. They were a little bit unusual. It just deflated them a little bit. They also, because they got off to such a bad start, kind of ended up having to chase the game far earlier than they'd expect. Yeah. If Leinster don't get one of those tries, which in fairness, the Orgy Snyder was definitely a knock on before one of those tries, they probably take one of those shots at goal. One of them was right in front of the posts, mm-hmm, if not two of them, I think, actually. Mm-hmm. So it does change the complexion of the game quite a lot if some of those decisions change, or if, they don't miss out on some of the opportunities that they created. So, I don't think it's the usual sporting adage, isn't it? You're never as far away as you think you are, and you're never as close as you are to greatness, you know? So I think they're in that kind of world for me, where few small things tweaked. Mm. It's in front of them, and I agree with Rory. I think that's a really good assessment. They'll still be in the hunt for the URC at the end of the season. I think the cup, I still feel they need to flesh out the squad in a couple of areas for them to be a challenge there. I think they're just a little bit short in the cup.
You look at their squad compared to Leinster's, and they really can't absorb injuries in the same way Leinster do. That's just not a possibility for them. Few clubs can, and they are down a number of pretty important players at the moment. Throw in the chaos that you mentioned, losing two hookers, the HIAs, Jeremy Lockman going down with his eye closed most of the game. And I think Croke Park probably was a factor in their heads as well. They maybe were a little bit spooked by it, and then they started getting worried that they were going to get hammered in Croke Park. And I'd say that there was a bit of terror there, that you don't want to be the team that gets beaten by 50 at Croke Park. And there was a moment after 12, 15 minutes where you were going, this could get out of hand for Munster. And the fact that they managed it and kept playing, Crowley impressed me with, yes, his kicking at time let him down, but he impressed me with his attitude. They had a plan to get around Leinster's defence. They knew where the space was, and I know Leinster almost dare you to go to that space, but they did it quite well. There were moments where Leinster's line speed absolutely snuffed them out and caused them big problems, but they committed to a plan and they stuck to it. I certainly wouldn't be writing them off on the back of this. It probably confirmed what we knew about these two teams. I have to say I was impressed with Leinster, and yeah. I probably came away with it. I've been quite critical of Leinster over the last year. Even when they were winning games, I saw so many flaws in what they did. I didn't see too many flaws about what they're doing this weekend. And you think about the players that they've brought in have improved them so much. They've only two more games before Jordy Barrett arrives. Like, where does he fit? You know, and that's, you think what that's done to Jamie Osborne. Robbie Henshaw's back this week. He's going, I got to forget about Jordy Barrett. I got to get Jamie Osborne out of the team. Hugo Keenan's thinking about Jamie Osborne. He's performing well. James Ryan comes into the team. And another factor in the line-out is the fact that Snyman knows Munster's calls and Ryan knows Ty Byrne, who's calling the line-out. So that's either in Ty Byrne's head, or it's also helping Ryan second guess what Dermot Barron or Niall Scanlon are doing out of touch. But Ryan saw what Orgie Snyman did in Treviso the previous weekend and went, well, I got to perform because I know I'm up against Joe McCarthy. And all these players are driving each other on. Rabas Nimini's not in the 23, so like Tom Clarkson plays well when he comes in. I know he was a flanker for some of the game, but you know, there is the competition there and the level of player that's going to, even Max Deegan comes in and was really
very good.
Brilliant.
He was excellent.
Yeah, he was.
So,
yeah.
You know, Munster don't have that calibre of player coming in and impacting games because of the injuries that they have. The 23 that they can pick if they have everyone fit is very good, but at the moment they don't have that 23. So that's a big factor. I think that Munster had to be at 100% to have any chance of winning, and they were about probably 80, 85, and probably below that at the start, whereas Leinster came in, they went, we're playing at Croke Park.
Oh, they
built
want to
it
put
up.
On a show.
They put
start.
On a show.
Kieran Doris said that afterwards. They really want to get off to a good start. You mentioned there Jack Crowley a few times. What about his opposite number, Ciarán Frawley?
Yeah, I thought he was excellent, wasn't he? I mean, he had a few sloppy parts himself, but you'd expect that. I think key thing for him now is that he gets a run of 10 or 15 games in there. Like,
so
that's
starts against Connacht this weekend?
I think you just keep playing him. Yeah. Like, I think you do what you... Like, the blueprint for it is fairly well trodden, you know. And Crowley, it's happened to Crowley the last kind of, you know, it's a year and a half, certainly with Ireland. They just keep playing him, you know. And that's what you need when you're this age. Like, yeah, it's a bit wearing on the body, a bit taxing, but you can be a bit more tactical as their career goes on. I think at this point, the more time they get feeling the pressure, running the show, whether it's in training or matches, I think obviously matches more important, that you get them on the pitch for them, the better he gets. And you can see a few of the touches. What I've been most impressed with, I probably didn't rate him as highly as I think his ball handling has really gone to another level. I think, you know, he looks really, really comfortable in there. Decision-making wise, and you love to see that little bit of power and strength that he has and the pace. It really makes a difference to have to defend that space. I mean, it was one of the great things about Johnny. Like, I think most tens that you can think of that are really great players, your Dan Carters, even Johnny Sexton, not like really quick, but fairly deceptive, has a good step. You have to defend him. And that's the thing. Like, I think Ross Byrne, while he's a really top class, you know, professional player and a really good 10, that's the one. But when you get to the top level, you don't really have to defend Ross because he doesn't have great pace. You know, if Frawley goes through, you might not catch him again. And I think Sexton, Carter, Wilkinson at their height, all these guys, Entomac, they all have that. And I think that's a really important facet to both Crowley and Frawley's game. And I think they're going to be big competitors over the next couple of years.
But even looking ahead to the November's, you know, 3 weeks' time, the All Blacks, and I assume like Jack Crowley. But where do you think Frawley is now in relation to...
I think he's right there next to him.
I think he is.
I think Crowley's definitely the incumbent. I think he's very, very solid. He's become a very polished, I think, international 10. I think he's our guy. But I think the more Frawley plays, and remember, Frawley's going to be playing with a pack that's probably dominating week in, week out. He's going to be hard. He's going to be like really nipping at his heels, I think. He's got the best job, I think, of all the provinces. Do you know what I mean? If you're thinking about the tens.
It's a nice window because it's four games on the trot. They will have to rotate the team to some degree. So both will get opportunities. I would be shocked if Jack Crowley didn't start against the All Blacks.
Yeah. What about Argentina?
He has earned it. Well, there's an opportunity there. Argentina are a very good team, but there is an opportunity there to maybe start Frawley. I would imagine maybe Frawley starts against Fiji the week later. I think Prendergast will be involved in that game to some degree, but and then it's up for grabs for the Australia game at the end. But if Crowley's fit, barring a radical drop off in form, we're in a position now where Frawley's a really good option. Even if Ireland want to go 6-2 on the bench, they could. You know, Frawley does cover that range of positions. Crowley can also bump out to 12 as well. Farrell likes Frawley. I'm sure his stock has risen even more because he won them the series over in South Africa. He will be certainly on the blower to Leo this week and keep playing him. Mm-hmm. Leo has a couple of things to manage there for this week and next week. There's only two games before November because there's a week off between Leinster's game against the Lions and the November Internationals. So I would imagine Ireland would love Frawley to have that rhythm, to keep playing, to go to Connacht, manage that game. I get the sense he probably will play this weekend, but he also needs to kind of keep the Burns on side. He's got Prendergast back from South Africa, so Leo has a couple of things to manage. But right now, Frawley looks fit, he looks strong, he looks confident.
He's just in this flow, I feel, as well.
Yeah, and like if he plays well the next 2 weeks, he goes into training and trains well, he's putting heat on Crowley, and that should get a response out of Crowley. The one thing, just having read Johnny Sexton's book, he does make the point in it, and of course he would say this, but he felt always that you want rotation and competition everywhere, but you're 10, he said, like there's a real value and consistency in knowing that you're playing every week, because if you're coming in on a Monday and you're giving messages, you can't have any uncertainty about whether you're playing on, you know, you need to know you're in a solid position if you're going to be able to do your job. So I can't see how they would leave Crowley out given what he's done in the last year, but I think there's a fire being lit underneath them. And knowing that Jack Crowley a little bit, I would suspect that he knows that and he will respond to that as well. And that's a really healthy place. And they all know that Prendergast is coming on. Like, they've just given Prendergast 3 starts on that tour. That whole tour was designed for Sam Prendergast.
Yeah, yeah.
Ireland like him. So he's not ready yet, but if you're thinking about being Ireland's 10 at the next World Cup, you know there's another guy coming there as well. So they'll be wary of him as well. They might not see him as a threat for tomorrow, but they'll see for right now, but they'll see him as a threat for tomorrow. So suddenly you're in a really nice spot. Like, Ireland have no hookers, but they've got 10s.
Yeah.
Who'd have thought we'd be in this position?
Yeah.
Do we want to get onto the hooker position now?
Well, yeah, sure.
So, obviously there's injury worries.
Well, in the immediate term, it's quite grim for Leinster because their top 3 hookers or top 4 hookers are all out. I believe Lee Barron's broken his foot, so he's out for a little while. So you've got Dan Sheehan on the long-term injury list with an ACL. You've got Ronan Keller has just done his ankle. He's gone for surgery. He's 4 to 6 weeks. Puts him very unlikely to play against the All Blacks. John McKee's on the long-term injury list. Barron's gone. So you've 2 academy hookers left. You've got Gus McCarthy, who I think has been excellent this season. Thought he was really good off the bench last weekend. He started the first 2 games. Ian Healy will be definitely considered as an option, but I think Rob Herring hasn't played yet this season. My understanding is he will be back for November. Tom Stewart won't. He's more December time. Barron and Scannell. Barron's been in camp. They like him. He was part of the pre-World Cup. He knows the system, he'll be an option. I don't know if he's considered to be big enough, but when you're in this situation, I think he'll probably be involved. Scannell went to New Zealand, he's a good option as well. Most recently, Dave Heffernan and Connacht was called out to the South Africa tour. He's in good form, he started the season really well. Yeah, he's a huge opportunity.
Yeah,
yeah. So I think him, Herring, and maybe Barron will be the 3. They might look at Gus McCarthy because he was captain of the 20s. He's rated within the system and he looks like he's ready to play. Whether he's ready for test match, I don't know, but he did go on Emerging Ireland. But you're missing a lot of good players in that department. It's a problem. Yeah. But it's an adversity for Andy Farrell, and it's he'll find out about his next tier, but I don't know if you want to be finding out your next tier when you're playing the All Blacks.
Yeah, no, for sure. Let's just go back to the game in session now. The Leinster defence, Caelan Dorr has kind of told us after the game that it's improved on last year, more clarity there. What did you make of it at the weekend?
I kind of looked at it a little bit differently. I think they'll come up against problems against teams with more threat out wide. Is my assessment of it. I think they got away with a few in the weekend. Munster actually created a few good opportunities but took some bad decisions at their times. He talked about the scramble defence, and I thought that's right. But also, I'd much rather not have to have as much. I thought they ended up in scramble situations too often, is my assessment of it. Now, I think they will get better. Again, the same applies to Leinster as it does to Munster, where it's kind of 4 games into the season, so I think they'll get better. But I think they'll. I still think they'll present opportunities to people who can get that ball to a second playmaker and who can pick a pass. I think that this system breaks down a little bit there. Or if you've got people with great footwork in that slot as well, because people are coming up so fast and so hard that they're kind of out of control at times. And I think, I know myself, the situation's not great to be getting a pass and you're getting hit man and ball. But if you have an extra half a second there and you've got footwork, I used to love that. That was my favourite situation because all I know, like if someone's coming that fast, it's very hard for them to change. And you remember, you're reacting to a situation. So if they're not in the perfect position, I always had a picture in my head. I know, and just know from looking at other people with good footwork, you have the picture in your head before it arrives. So remember, they're always reacting, and it's very hard to react at that pace. I'm thinking Gary Ringrose is the guy in that situation more often than not. But James Lowe and that too can find themselves very high up the pitch, very exposed, almost like island-like. And if they get
Larmer in the final,
yeah, exactly, Larmer. And if you make one bad decision there against the speedsters, against real speedsters, it's over generally. So I don't think Leinster come into any problems in the part of the season that we know they're great in. But in the real serious end of it, I think they might call. They might. I think they still might present the same problems, this defensive system, even though it looks great when a team is not playing, is not able to break it down that
it's
often.
It's a real pity they're not going to South Africa to play a couple of South African teams this week, because this will be a lovely time for them to have a tour. Like Munster are going there, and Graham are actually really, really like positive about it. They love going to South Africa, whereas Leinster's tour to South Africa is timed. I think it's just after the Six Nations, and they'll bring a B team again. And they really actually would benefit from going to the High Vels and playing against the Bulls and the Lions and like pace.
Willie LaRue picked them apart.
With the stakes much lower, but also just, you know, try this out against these guys, and it will be such a good experience for them. Munster didn't, like, if Takir Abrahams was on the pitch, they might have been able to finish some of those moves. I thought Crowley was smart in the way he drew the defence onto him. There was one time where he did what Sexton was doing at the World Cup at times. He just stood still, gave it to Byrne stood still, gave it out. He brought them onto them and they went around. Now, when it works, there was the one where the lineup came down and Murray had to pick it off the ground, which gave Leinster an extra second. But they won two phases, one after another. They drove that Munster back by about 50 metres and two unbelievable crunching tackles, winning the collisions. You could, the energy they could draw off that in a closer game, the crowd feeds off that as well. There is, when it works, it's brilliant, but it's the times when it doesn't that it just looks so exposed, and that's what makes it so interesting. I know you're not
it's
a fan.
I am. You always want to simplify things as much as possible there, because it gives you, like, the same as Munster kind of struggling, or you're looking for that kind of cohesiveness and togetherness. It's really nice to have one message, and that is we're off the line no matter what.
Yeah.
But I think there's more to it than that, and I think it's more nuanced. The best defences that I played in did a bit of both. They were hard up the line, like they were just kind of opportunistic about which one they chose. So if you're down numbers, you went soft. And I think it's still a pretty simple system to understand. If you're up numbers, you're off the line putting pressure on, or if you're you know, even numbers. Whereas this one is just constantly off the line. So I don't love that. I feel like it burns out some of your bigger players. It forces you into substitutions there, which is fine. Like Leinster have great depth, South Africa have great depth, Ireland have great depth, and they're all the teams that are doing it to probably, you know, using the system probably, you know, to its best effect. But I still think big teams pick it apart. The really good teams with good ball players and good footwork and good pace. I just don't like how often you end up in a situation where you have to scramble. And it's great that you all scramble for each other, but you shouldn't be in that situation. I wish they contained teams a bit better.
Connacht will test it this week, because Connacht's back three. Connacht's midfield are good ball players. They're, you know,
dangerous.
Murphy and Ioane, if they get the quick ball, and Leinster, Leinster's work at the breakdown was really good at the weekend. That helps, you know, if you dirty up the ball. But if Connacht can get a clean supply of possession, they've got threats out wide. They've got the game style. You know, Hansen has done really well against South Africa over the years. It's a game he's really enjoyed. So I think Connacht is a good fixture. And then the Lions are coming to the Aviva the following week, so they're not bad games to test them. So
Bundy's tricky there too. He can ball play, and he's a big man. He's got footwork and pace. He's kind of the full package, really, attack wise. So they will get tested there, but it's just whether, you know, because you do have to get that little bit of respect in tight. It's where the South African teams really have an advantage over everyone else, that they have these huge kind of ball carriers where, even with that pressure, you might not send them backwards like some of the Munster guys were kind of sent backwards. And I think most of the teams that they'll play in the league, they can probably bully them to a certain extent. Probably not against South Africa. And I think when Munster have a full their full outfit, maybe not as well. Certainly can't do that against the big French teams either. That's kind of, they're the ones where I foresee a problem with this situation, with this kind of defensive system. But that might be me just being overly cautious. They did look very good against Munster on the weekend. I have to say.
The things that have concerned me about them over the last year, I just didn't see them as much on Saturday. I do think the addition of the players that they brought in, a full pre-season under Niamh Aber, Blind Al appears to have just tweaked things a little bit. They look like they have more energy in attack. They're not coming off the back of a World Cup. You know, there was definitely an underlying, whether it was mental or physical fatigue, but that that definitely bled into it to some degree last year as well. There's a freshness about them. It's a very heady cocktail. I think there's not many teams can live with them if they play that way. The problem always is that the teams that can live with them, they won't see until May or June. But I'm feeling they're better set up for it this year.
Could we read too much into the fact that they didn't score in the second half? I mean, they had the bonus point wrapped up by halftime.
Luke can probably speak to the mentality of that a bit more in terms of like what it's like when you have the game won and you've got, you know, you're trying to manage it out. But they are, I think Niamh Aber does focus a little bit on being efficient, you know, like that old Michael Collins line, like, don't be riddling them, lads, keep the bullets, keep, you know, keep something in reserve. I'm sure the first 20 took it out of them as well. Like, it was a fairly intense effort. They did a couple of injuries. Baird going off was bad timing, so they probably lost their rhythm a little bit. But yes, there is a trend in games where they go away in the second half. And even it was interesting, I was on Connacht's media call this morning and Pete Wilkins was talking about how their focus this week is to not let Leinster. It sounds obvious, sounds easy, but it's like they're targeting the first 20 minutes to break teams, and then they can manage games from there. So the key is to get them into the last. Even Ian Madigan said it yesterday: get Leinster into the last 20 minutes, you're in a game, because they've shown that they can be got at. That's what other teams perceive as their weakness. So there is a sense, I think, out there that if you stop Leinster scoring heavily in the first 20, you can get them to where you want them. But whether it's really an issue, whether it's hard to read into an early season game where you played out well in the first 20. Mm. Part of me wants to say, God, you should. It's up against your biggest rivals in front of 82,000 people. Why not keep your foot in the pedal?
But I can understand the efficiency argument, though, as well.
I don't think you're thinking out there that you're going to be efficient, though. Right. That's the one thing. I'd say a lot of the turnover in... the turnover in players, guys, people getting injured, you know, line out, you know, there's a lot of kind of stuff that you're kind of thinking, you definitely lost the momentum. You also have Munster kind of pushing to get back into the game. So they're kind of in the game the whole way through.
And they got a handle on Munster.
And Munster had a few opportunities here and there that I felt like they didn't get unbelievably disheartened by the fact that, you know, like there's a team, you're going to say, okay, they're just running at the gate here. Let's just try not get injured. Like we're too far away to get a losing bonus. I never felt that, and Munster probably in this fixture would never allow that to happen anyway. So there's probably two sides to that coin. I would agree with Rudd, though, in that you do probably want to see a little bit of ruthlessness and a bit of let's we foot on the throat now, let's press down and make sure we kind of put an exclamation mark behind that. I think the first 20 minutes probably did that for most people anyway, but I agree with you on the point that, not scoring the second half, there's too much quality for themselves.
Those penalties that time
even
as
the
well.
Treviso game or over in Benetton, they didn't keep the foot on the floor, but again, they did their damage in the first half. So I guess we have to wait until they don't do the damage in the first half and see how they handle this. A tight second half. Maybe we'll see it. They needed a last minute try to be Connacht away last year, and they are. It looks like going to rotate a little bit this week. We might get a more of a sense of whether they'll. When they need it, will they be able to turn it on in the second half? I can't see why they wouldn't. Mm.
What about the referee? You mentioned him earlier.
Well, I think Munster had a... We talked about it off air, Rudds. I didn't think the dialogue was great with Byrne. I thought that was a really unusual decision to not go... To be honest with you, for a try-scoring opportunity, I'm not clamouring for a referee to be making a decision himself. I want the game to be sped up. But that just felt to me on reflection, like on watching it, with the new rules, I don't love this hands going backwards thing. I'm not a massive fan of that, but that is the ruling. And I just felt, looking at Nankivell, I wasn't unbelievably convinced at you know, the camera angle wasn't great for it anyway. But I wasn't convinced from that camera angle that it was definitely not a try. Or it was definitely forward. It looks slightly forward, but not enough to be calling it yourself. I was unconvinced personally, and I just thought that was a bad call. As I said, I didn't like some of the dialogue with Byrne, but I also think Byrne and Doris, there's a little bit of they're still kind of feeling it, like kind of their how the dialogue should go with the referee, when they should interject and when they shouldn't. I thought both guys, you can see they're unbelievable competitors, but they were competing with the referee all the time too, almost, where you're kind of constantly in his ear. You have to pick and choose your battles a little bit. I thought the best guy to watch on that is McCaw. McCaw was really good at just shutting up at the right time, I thought. He kind of knew when to get out of the referee's way, but also he knew when to say, listen, here's a nice little opportune moment, whether it's an injury or whether it's something where you go up to the ref and say, here, you know, feeling like this is happening a little bit. I think there are better times to approach the referee rather than all the time, because if he's hearing a constant din, I think that's when you get some of those bad reactions that I thought both players on occasion got it a little bit, you know. So
it was a feature of Johnny's book where he's talking about that his own kind of captaincy, I'm trying not to say journey, but his own captaincy journey, and the times early on where he would get on the wrong side of refs, and Stuart Lancaster, I believe it was, like, showed him footage. He goes, like, doesn't matter what you're saying, look at the way you're saying it, look at, you're towering over a referee. It's the same as he had to adapt how he talked to younger players as he went on, because Leo pulled him aside once and said, look, these guys watched you win Champions Cups, you can't talk to them the way you used to talk to me or Brian O'Driscoll. You're their hero. If you rinse them in front of a whole group, they're gonna feel it. So he adapted and became better as he went on, and by the end he was very good at communicating. He probably got away with more because he had the status. And like Doris during the summer got himself, now I Luke Pearce
that was actually in fairness that he Luke Pearce did get a
Luke Pearce like Ireland with that like went after yeah, backed yeah, him yeah. And Luke Pearce did get a bit of a
censor or whatever,
but it definitely did it, the following week certainly Doris got a lot more of a hearing. But you know, James Ryan last year when Matt Carley refused to talk to him in La Rochelle would only talk to Ringrose. There's a little bit of a trend, and I think these players, like, I've no problem with
it
being.
I think he merited it, though. What,
no, with Byrne, I think, and you can sense Byrne's frustration. There was the knock-ons. There was
a few bad decisions. I thought, like, the knock-on was atrocious. I thought,
yeah. There was two decisions in build up the tries that I'd say Munster just felt, and also they were played with 14 men when they shouldn't. When the third try went over, they should have been allowed to replace the second hooker when he was coming off for his HIA. Now that's maybe up to Niall O'Donovan on the sideline to remonstrate and make sure it doesn't happen. But also the ref, that's a mistake by the officials. I accept it's hard, but that's a pretty bad disadvantage to have when Leinster are all over you. So I could understand why the sense of grievance is there. Byrne is a relatively new captain. I thought, watching the second game, Brace being the more experienced referee, I thought he handled that occasion much better. He didn't take any crap. He was marching players back 10, but he just had more control. I thought I could understand why Munster would be aggrieved by a number of decisions in the game, albeit they were second best, but it doesn't help when you're not getting the rubber green.
No. And they were kind of key moments. Like, the try is a key moment, you know, and I think there was a few, as you said, a few other ones that you're kind of just saying, look, just that's a bad day at the off as well. So it compounds the challenges that you're having anyway. So, yeah.
We want the refs at the biggest games, and like, Busby has to do games like this to get better. And, like, you know, I wouldn't write him off as a ref by any means, but it's a tough place for him to do it as well. So you'd hope that, like, he's going to improve from it as well, because we want Irish refs at the top level as well.
Yeah. Anything else from the game?
Not much. I thought, like, it was still a great, like, to get that number
incredible
of people at a derby match, I think is brilliant, and it's a really good indication for, like, I know people were, like, obviously we had some kind of fairly negative comments about Munster's performance, but I think they do get better, and I would say that it's still brilliant that 82,000 people were in the stadium, and I think, you know, it's an indication of how far the league has come that they're able to get that at this early stage. Like, that's a fourth round game. Do you know, that's it's not a nothing
points
game, but it's, that's it. Yeah, so I thought that was brilliant. And I there's plenty of positive on show across the board. You know, I thought, like, some of the young backs I thought looked pretty decent at times. Like, O'Brien looked pretty good, I thought, at times, that he finished
Tom
the try very well.
I mean,
Tom Farrell looks good
Osborne
there.
Osborne,
like, he is a proper talent. Like, he had some brilliant moments, some brilliant tackling, some great offloading. Like, I think he's going to be, like, Leinster, he could be playing himself into a position where Leinster have to find somewhere to play him. That's how good I think he's playing.
Is he starting against the All Blacks?
At 12? I don't think so. I think it's still Aki and Ring Road.
Oh, yes, yeah. And actually,
but if the opening Champions Cup final Henshaw's game, Henshaw's available as well. And McCluskey hasn't been playing recently, so I don't know what his status is. But he's definitely getting himself into, you know, I mean, he's a live option for 15 as well, although Keenan's playing really well.
Would you think of the wing, Rudd? I think of the wing he might be.
Matt Hansen.
Well, like, I just think, Matt Hansen's back, but like, I just think, certainly on a bench, you wouldn't be afraid to put him on there. Like, he's good in the air. He's a good tackler. He's a nice passing game. He's a good. You can see he was. If you're able to fill in a 15 in an international match in South Africa and do it bloody well, you can definitely play on the wing.
We can play on the wing, and he can play. Like, he is. I'd say he will win at least two caps in November. It's just the All Blacks game.
No, they'll have the specialists.
You'd imagine that Farrell's going to play the hits, but at the same time, as he kind of starts thinking about the next 6 months where he's not going to be around, this does feel like the time where Ireland are going to pivot.
So I
wouldn't write him off at all, especially if he plays well the next 2 weeks. It's a pity for him there's no Champions Cup between now and November for him to really go out against a French team or a big English team and have a dominant performance. It's, you know, Henshaw's back this week. I don't know if that means he'll be buffered somewhere else. Maybe Farrell will put a call and say, can we really play him here? Yeah. But like, he is Ireland's number 15 coming into this. He's got the jersey. It's up to Keenan to train the house down and take it off him, which is an incredible position for them to be in. I wouldn't say he's in just yet.
You say,
but I'd say on a Monday
bench,
definitely an option.
He fits so many positions.
Yeah, absolutely. Himself and Frawley on the bench, it's just you've got
everything covered.
Yeah. So I think he's in a really, really good position. And I think when the Monday of that they come in, when they're talking about selection, he is firmly, it's not just, you know, he'll be in that squad as a live option. Just with everyone fit, I think it's Hansen Lowe on the wings, it's Henshaw, sorry, it's Aki and Ringrose probably at midfield. It's Crowley and Gibson Park at 9-10. It's hard to, that combination has achieved so much. But there's two rounds to go and people are starting to drop. So you just don't know who will be available.
And Kabir, before we leave the Munster Leinster game, so you think their trip to South Africa now is coming at a good time for Munster, do you think?
Yeah, they've done a really good job of making this tour. Leinster seem to view the trip to South Africa as an awful pain, and it just comes across. And every time they talk about South Africa, they, you know, Leo sighs, and it just comes across as like, this is just the greatest burden. Whereas Roundtree, they've found a hotel in Cape Town. Leinster should get a recommendation. They love it. They go down there. They're playing in the first. They're going to Cape Town and Durban, two of the nicer places to tour in South Africa. They're not playing at altitude. Stormers and the Sharks are not going great either. They go. They're over there already. They're staying in a place where they like. They're playing against a Stormers team that they know they can beat. They think that they can get momentum out of these two games, but they got to perform as well. You know, they won't just be able to turn up and beat these two teams. But there's a bit of confidence, a bit of residual confidence from previous trips where they've won both games. And there's a few, like, they've got Shane Daly, Billy Burns, and one other back, Rory Scannell back. And that's just a little bit of depth, a little bit of options. Alex Kendallin's back. The other emerging Ireland players have come down. I have actually stayed in South Africa. They have a stronger squad than they did last weekend. So they're going there needing at least one win, I think, to just keep the show on the road. Then there's a break and we're back for Europe straight after November. So there's one round of games before November, but the internationals will be away. So they could do it winning at least one game, but they've won games in South Africa before. I think this is a key little 2 week window for them, and they feel like they can get a lot out of it.
Yeah, okay, we'll see how they go. So let's move on to Ulster 32, Connacht 27. This was a cracking game. So it was tied at 24 points apiece after the hour mark. Dylan Tierney Martin scored a try, but then with 10 minutes to go, Josh Murphy got a red card after earlier getting a yellow. Cooney kicked the penalty. Nick Timoney got the try then at the end to complete the win. So a second win of the season for them, Luke. And it was the first game at home since they got that opening 1 point win over Glasgow in round one. So a good win for them.
Timely. Yeah. They really needed it and they looked under pressure, I think. I think Josh Murphy's actually got off to a brilliant start to the season.
Well,
he's been really good, like very, very physical, looks in great shape. That's a loose one. And I know what he's trying to do. He's trying to check the fella coming in, but it's very loose to hit him that high. And I think, I wouldn't be surprised if there's something off the back of it.
There's a hearing. We haven't got details of it, but
because he doesn't have the ball.
I thought he was in November contention. I really like him. I don't know. Ireland have never had him in before, but he's such a big, big player. He's physical. He's got a good bit of attitude about him. He can play second row, back row. and he's just put himself probably out of contention for that squad. I mean, now whether he was in it or not, I'm not sure. He's probably behind
it. Knocking on the door.
Options, but he's a big blow. Really, you know, even for this weekend, but it was a no brainer decision. You know, pardon the pun. It was a Stonewall red, and he had a yellow card in the first half as well. So it wasn't he was definitely getting a second yellow for it.
For a guy, like, he's clearly super smart fella. Yeah, he's a doctor, you know what I mean? So
he could have done the HIA as well.
Exactly, yeah. Made himself useful. But yeah, I don't know. It's not a good look for a guy who, like, because I think he's, if you have him in the row, he's undersized. If you have him at six, he's probably the perfect size, but I don't know if he's got the pace for it. He's going to be leaning on his physicality and you'd think probably the brain power, you know, whether that's in lineouts or whatever it is, or just impacts around the pitch. That's a bad one. And he let his team down there. So that's unusual for him. And I think, as I said to reiterate, like, let his team down badly at a crucial moment when Ulster has been a tough place for them to go. They've had a bit of success in recent times, but traditionally speaking, that was a graveyard for Connacht teams.
You have, like, you've gone into the last 10 minutes against an Ulster team, have lost two, and, like, scraped by Glasgow, and, like, good win, but, you know, Glasgow were the better team that night, and you have a real chance to go, to be in the top two or three after, and you get a red card. And then even when, after Cooney kicks the goal, Joshuani has a chance to put them in the corner. And like he did against Munster, and he played well overall, and he kicked the points at the end to get them the bonus. But that's a bit of a coach killer, and I that's something he needs to nail. You know, I mean, he has been very good in certain aspects, but that's not good enough, and that's it.
I mean, they could have won down in Munster.
It's serious echoes of last season. I think they're conceding a good few tries still.
Overall, do you not think they have improved though in last season?
No, I think they've definitely improved going forward. You know, they're definitely, I think, it from an attack perspective, like a way bigger threat, I think, than they were. But I still feel like some defensive issues, I think. And if you think about last season, they had a few where they should have won the Leinster match. They should have won, like, how they let Frawley in for that last try. That was just really loose. They had one against Ulster as well, if you remember, where they kind of had the game nearly sewn up. I don't know. I hope that they've opportunities to kind of win a couple of these big games. And the flip side of this is that they come out of them with no wins, and it really is a momentum killer. Like, you know, and they're in positions to win them. So the key thing for them, the trick for them, is getting over the line, tightening up a little bit defensively, getting a few of these wins, because it looks the complexion of their season would look completely different if they had that win then in Munster, which was very doable, and if they got that one on the weekend, because they were writing that one up there.
If only we had another Interpro this weekend.
Well, at least this, like, the one thing they have gone for them, they've got 13 points on the board after four games. They're fifth in the table. Three of their games have been away from home. Pete Wilkins was on the media call this morning, and in fairness, if he thought he was feeling good about life going in, the local media fairly hammered him in the first three questions with, like, is this weekend a must-win game? You've been leaking tries. You seem to have a problem in the Interpro. So it was like, he handled it pretty well. But there's high expectations out west. And the one big difference they have this season to last is that they're not in the Champions Cup. And it's a blessing in disguise, because they can focus everything on the URC. They will have less players in the November squad, might have one or two more than they had last year, but they can go for that fourth game. The last game in November clashes with the Australia game, so they will be strong that weekend. So you know, they can put points on the board when other teams have a bit of distractions. They won't have to rotate for Europe. They'll probably play a slightly weakened team in Challenge Cup and get through it. So then they can go hard at the November or at the Christmas Interpros. There's a few things stacking up for them.
Key guys though, Rudds, will probably, like, you think Beelum is definitely going to be involved. You think,
yeah, that's true.
Aki, you think Hansen. They give them a big lift, I think. Now, the only thing is, you've got a few emerge, like, your Murphy looks like a real player, doesn't he? I know we'll probably discuss him a little bit more, but Ioane's been good.
Bodies, like, their injury list is really good at the moment, and they've got bodies in. So this is where they have to make hay. That's
why
leaving points
behind.
Well,
I think Prendergast is he
on an Ireland point of view?
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. He's in the squad.
He's definitely in the squad. Think, he probably doesn't play, maybe, but he's playing very well.
No, I think players
would one of the games, would he?
At least.
Yeah, but
one,
now Heffernan probably goes in too. So, like, I think maybe they're, like, I agree in principle compared to say a Leinster, but those guys are fairly key for Connacht, you know. So I think that impacts them badly when they
having so many players available right now means that. Really, you can't be leaving points behind you at Thomond Park and Ravenhill. Like, really, they could be 4-4, so that's a frustration for them. But they are at least picking up. Their points management is good. They're leaving they're coming home with something in the bag, and they're in a nice position with lots to improve on. If you're glass half full, you go, like, they're playing lovely rugby. They look like they're confident. They've a lot more belief, and if they, you know, they need to stop. Both Connacht and Ulster were unbelievably good with the driving maul. They were terrible at defending the driving maul. Yeah. I mean, like surely their whole training is—it's not just you're scoring.
Their
someone's
their
trying
good
to stop
maul
it.
Is being defended against.
So like, there's got to be some improvements to be made there as well. So like, that's something you can tighten up.
The thing is, where this becomes an issue for them is that at key parts of the season, I think they lose. Like, every single one of their guys is involved pretty much. I think Heffernan will be involved now, and Bar Prendergast will probably come out because he won't start, might not be in the squads. But like, you think Aki will definitely be in the squads or playing. Hansen definitely in the squad or playing. So they get actually, while they have less players in total in, the guys who are in, if you know what I mean. And they do have a big impact. And where this becomes a problem for them, I think, in throwing away the games that they probably should be winning or are very close to winning, which they did last season too, is at the end of the season, where they just, if they get a couple of injuries after Six Nations or whatever it is, after November, it hits them a little bit worse, and it's a bit harder because their just squad is a bit skinnier, so they have less scope to kind of win a few more games if they go down a few bodies, which in fairness, it's a long season for guys playing international rugby to go through international windows with no injury or afterwards is kind of unusual.
You mentioned Ben Murphy there, scored his fourth try of the season, keeping Caelan Blade on the bench, a man who gave that pass obviously to Ciarán Frawley for that drop goal over in South Africa. Could he go in as a training panellist?
I think at the moment you'd say I don't think he does, but he's bloody close. He might go in as a that kind of
the training panellist. Yeah,
the fourth is that. Sorry, is that what you said? Sorry, excuse me, Sinead. Sorry, I didn't listen to you properly. I didn't take in the information properly, because I don't think he goes in as the top three. I think that's fairly set at the moment. Still,
part of the you know.
Well, I think there's definitely some learnings from there. You know, and. The other side of that is, does he try and keep the momentum going with Connacht? And is he then a real threat for Six Nations, which might be a better, you know, you think that maybe that Italy game might be a shot to give him a go. I think he's playing brilliant rugby. Very exciting. And I think this weekend will be a real test for him against Leinster, you know, where the pack mightn't be. I think it's probably easier for that pack to get parity against Munster and Ulster, not so against Leinster, depending on, of course, who's selected. But even Leinster's kind of second string pack, very, very difficult to contain over 80 minutes. And I think that defence as well is, while I've obviously pointed out some issues, I don't think Connacht are one of the teams to really highlight. They might highlight it, but... I think he might be going backwards a bit more this week. So we probably see a bit more of Cuddy Lass at international level. And look, if he doesn't do well this weekend, it's not the end of the world. There'll be good learnings from it. It might be how he reacts to maybe a tough weekend or a tough day at the office. So either way, him starting this weekend is a good thing. And he's got off to a super start. So I'm really pleased to see that. Looks like an exciting talent playing in an exciting team, I think, hopefully. So hopefully we see a good bit of him from that side of the game.
It usually takes more of a body of work to get into Andy Farrell's squad. So he values consistency, I think, above nearly anything else. And I wonder, he was on the Emerging Ireland Tour 2 years ago, so that they've had a look at him, they know him. Obviously, he's Richie's son, so they know him as well from that. Like, they all know Richie, he was part of the setup for a long time. So they wouldn't have any fear about him if there was an injury or two. He also doesn't generally carry more than 3 scrum halves. I think if you have a 4th scrum half, they have very little to do with training. So they like to have 3 scrum halves, they keep that tight, and they'll want to get Casey minutes. Murray's the one. Like, does Murray need to play against Fiji? Fiji are a good team, so I wouldn't write that fixture off. But if you're trying to go, well, will Murray be around for the next World Cup? Then maybe you have another one. But like, Devine is another. Now, he hasn't played, but Devine went to the Emerging Ireland Tour. He's a quality player. And there was just a little bit in Wilkins today where he was saying, look, Ben's been brilliant, but I do have other scrum halves. I wonder if Blade plays this weekend. So there might be. Like, squad management does come into it. We're 5 games in. Murphy started all 4, I think. So certainly started 3 of them. Yeah. So, you know, there is a little bit of, like, his momentum could get checked a little bit. And I think he's quality and he could play for Ireland. I just wonder if knowing the way Farrell runs things, he just generally looks for a bit more of a body of work.
Yeah, no, fair enough. Before we go, Rory, the draw for next year's World Cup will be made on Thursday. Ireland will be among the second seeds after their wins in the WXV1 competition over the past few weeks. They, of course, finished 2nd overall, which is incredible. I mean, they really will go into next year with a lot of confidence, won't they?
Yeah, and it's not based on anything other than their own good performances. Yeah. it's amazing what happens when you meld the sevens and the 15s programs and you bring back players who were exiled for a number of years, and suddenly you have
you actually pick
the players that the best players were available for the 15s team, and you suddenly have a team. But you put Aaron King and Aoife Wafer into the same back row, and suddenly you're winning collisions, and we know that's so important to in rugby. They look like the, you know, Dan O'Brien is looking like the experience of, she was a bit of a grueler at the start of her international career, but she looks like she's able to control games much better now. They just look like they're coming of age as a team. It's important, I think, not to get too carried away. There's the Six Nations first. They need to back this up now in that Six Nations. You know, England and France, for the men's, that's the real challenge. But for the men, having England and France at home
is a good thing.
And then you go away to the three teams that are more beatable. Whereas in women's rugby, now they're pretty closer to France now than they were, and England.
Well, they finished above them in the table.
And they're better than Italy, Wales and Scotland, but they're less better than the men are. So it is tricky to have to go away. They'd like to have at least one of them at home.
Yeah.
But they have good reason to be confident. You know, the draws on Thursday, isn't it, Sinead?
Yeah,
so
yeah,
like that's like they weren't at the world next last World Cup, so they're making strides already. But you get the sense that they are starting to believe that, I don't think they're going there to win it. I know Scott Beaman said that they think they can get to knockouts. Mm. That should be the least they're expecting to do. They can take some scalps there as well. But everyone will be better at that tournament. We know that from previous World Cups. We know that from men's World Cups. That team, you know, you might be New Zealand during the cycle, but it's a different matter.
Especially
the women have done it in 14. Yeah, but you know, the Black Ferns will be better. Everyone will be better at the World Cup. Everyone will peak for that. But it's... Beaman and his team are doing a really good job. They've been backed. You know, the amount of money that's been put into that program is substantial now, and we're now seeing the rewards. You'd like to see the players play a bit in domestic competitions. You'd like to see a bit of, like, the women who are interested in this. Sorry, the fans who are interested in this will be able to see the women who are playing a bit more in the next couple of months.
Get that support base going.
Yeah, because if you're like one of the reasons 82,000 people turned up at Croke Park last week is because they get to see Caelan Doris, Gary Ringrose, Jack Crowley,
and
they build that. I don't know when these players are playing their next game, and when they do, it'll probably be in the Celtic Challenge Cup, which, you know, it's the Clovers and the Wolf. Yeah, so it's not identifiable teams. I know we're building towards the provinces, but there's still work to be done. It's not there, but God, it's just a relief to be talking about a winning team again, isn't
for sure,
it? Because it was such a difficult period for them. And for them, like, that was a tough time. It was a tough time. I know you mentioned Greg last night, Greg McWilliams. It was a tough time for him. It was a tough time for everyone involved. The players who stepped away, I wonder if they'll approach any of them and say, like Nicola Friday, look, would you consider coming back? Because again, the best players who are playing on the field, you know, Kieran Griffin's winning or playing
in county finals.
So maybe she'll fancy a World Cup. But look, it's a much better story, and it's just, the only shame was, I know you stayed up for Sinead, but the kickoff times, the fact it was in such a tricky time zone was unfortunate, because if it was on primetime TV, people, I think, would have bought into it more, and it would have probably captured more of the imagination. But look, it's a good stepping stone. To finish second was a really good achievement.
That was fantastic. Before we go, the 20-minute red card trialling, you're not a fan, Luke.
Is that a question? No, I'm not. I think it's silly. Yeah, I think, you know, it's a bit of a cop-out for, you know, it seems to be driven by kind of Southern Hemisphere, I'm going to say. Probably one nation in particular. Yeah, look, I think, you know, it's there to have a real impact on the game. It's supposed to be a real deterrent to kind of poor play, either, you know, really cynical play or really dangerous play. And I think it's being used correctly. And I think it should be, you know, the impact is so great that it should be changing behaviours. The problem is, if you're not moving with it, that some people are now looking for an avenue out, saying that it's only 20 minutes because it ruins the spectacle. But I would just say that the behaviour, particularly if you think about the World Cup final, those tackles are just very loose, you know, and I think that's probably the one area where we're kind of saying, oh, our biggest spectacle, you know, they're probably, Sia Khaleesi probably should have got a red card too, but Kane obviously got one, and you never want to see that. But I just think that the tackle behaviour was still too poor. And that's the, unfortunately, in our biggest on the biggest occasion, you know, we had to brandish a few red cards, which you never want to see. But I think it's happening in soccer World Cups too. You think it's Zidane, like, you know, it's part of sport, you know. And a red card should be, you're off the pitch and that's it for the rest of the, you know, your team have to figure it out for the rest of the game.
It's possible to adapt. Like, you sound a bit smug saying it, but the Irish players have you know, Josh Murphy the weekend being an exception, but Irish players have largely adapted to the laws as they stand, and it's rare in a big game an Irish player gets done for a high shot. I know O'Mahony got a red card a couple of years ago, Aki got a couple, but really, like, if you look at that Ireland-South Africa game at the World Cup, really high level game, one of the most physical games I've ever seen, even the one in the second test in South Africa. Yeah. Incredible physicality, but all within, well, you know, certainly within the bounds of the high tackle law. You know, it was tough, it was confrontational, but it was legal, and New Zealand players don't seem to have adapted to this in the same way. Sam Kane seems to get on the wrong side of it more than most, but even the reason they lost, they drew the Lions series in 2017 is because Sonny Bill was sent off. The series in New Zealand, Angus Tuivasa was sent off against Ireland, that turned that series partly in Ireland's favour. And they, rather than adapt and coach their players to tackle better, they're rattling on about the laws. Now, they're under pressure from Rugby League over there in terms of numbers and interest, and they feel like this is one of the reasons fans are turning towards Rugby League, because if they go on report, it's dealt with afterwards rather than within the game. But I think if Rugby wants to be serious about this issue, and it has been, a red card is a proper deterrent.
Okay, Rory and Luke, thank you very much for that. Right. We'll be back again next week. Thank you for listening.